The Presocratics Lecture 2, The Milesians. In the last lecture, we introduced the Presocratics, noted why they are significant, and explained the difference between mythology and philosophy. In this lecture, we will discuss the earliest Presocratics, Thales, Anaximander, and Anaximenes, who are widely considered the first philosophers in Western civilization. All three philosophers lived in the city of Miletus in the 6th century BC, and for this reason are referred to as the Milesians. Miletus was located in Ionia on the western coast of Asia Minor, or what today is western Turkey. The Milesians were physiologists, as they attempted to provide a rational account, or logos, of nature, the Greek word for nature being physis, hence the word physiologist, or one who provides a logos of physis. Note that today the word physiologist has a different meaning. In attempting to give a rational account of nature, Thales, Anaximander, and Anaximenes were all interested in the fundamental question, what is the world made of? Looking out into the world, they noted that reality displays two fundamental characteristics. Firstly, everything in the world is constantly changing or constantly in flux. This is why philosophers often call the world we perceive as a world of becoming, as everything is always becoming something else. Secondly, they observed that for all practical purposes, there are an infinite plurality of different things in the world. In other words, any single thing that exists is different than anything else that exists, has existed, or will ever exist. The world displays infinite variation. When the Milesians asked what is the world made of, they concluded that underlying the plurality of things in this world, and underneath all the transformations these things undergo, there exists a single and permanent substance. In other words, they proposed that everything in the world is made of the same stuff, and that this stuff, although undergoing modifications in this world, always retains its unity and fundamental identity. This material substance underlying the world, the ancient Greeks called the arche. David Ruchnik explains the meaning of the term. First principle translates the Greek arche, but it could also be rendered as origin, source, beginning, and significantly, ruler. The arche is thus the origin that persists and continues to exert authority. In the above quote, as we've already explained, Ruchnik notes that the arche is the underlying source and origin of all things. But what does he mean when he says that the arche was thought of as the ruler, or as exerting authority? In order to understand this idea, we must heed the advice of the early 20th century professor of ancient philosophy, Francis Cornford, who stressed that if we would understand the 6th century philosophers, we must disabuse our minds of the atomistic conception of dead matter in mechanical motion, and of the Cartesian dualism of matter and mind. The arche, the underlying substance and source of all things, was thought by the Milesians to be a physical or corporeal material, as the concept of immaterial spirit or pure mind had not yet been arrived at by the Greeks. However, at the same time, this underlying substance was thought to be alive and endowed with spirit, considered to be divine, and imbued with intelligence. The arche, being alive, was therefore the author of its own movement, or self-caused, so to speak, and hence was the ruler of all things, and exerted its authority by guiding the birth, transformations, and death of all things. This view, that matter is imbued with life and intelligence, and is also divine, is called hylozoism. With respect to the question, what is the arche made of, each Milesian offered a different answer, and we will now proceed to investigate exactly what Thales, Anaximander, and Anaximenes proposed to be the source and underlying identity of the world. Philosophy, Bertrand Russell declared in his book A History of Western Philosophy, begins with Thales. As the first philosopher, Thales is credited with proposing the first philosophical account of the universe, and he concluded that the substance underlying everything, the arche, is water. Aristotle elaborated on this idea, contemplating why Thales would have chosen water as the arche. His supposition may have arisen from the observation that the nourishment of all creatures is moist, and that warmth itself is generated from moisture and lives by it, and water is for most things the origin of their nature. However, since so little is known about Thales, this idea is mere conjecture, and all we can safely say with any certainty is that he thought everything in the world was made of water. But remember, the early Presocratics were hylozoists, so this water was no ordinary water. It was alive, divine, intelligent, and the source and ruler of everything that exists in the world. We know quite a bit more about Anaximander's ideas, and in order to understand his main proposition regarding the nature of the arche, we must first discuss a belief that was widespread in ancient Greece. The Greeks thought the world and everything in it was made of four primary elements: earth, water, fire, and air. Anaximander, building on such a belief, reasoned that since each of these elements is finite and limited, none of them can be the arche. Thales, he concluded, was wrong to claim the arche was water. For the arche, if it is to exist, cannot be limited, for it is the eternal underlying source of everything, and therefore must be something unlimited. Anaximander proposed that the arche was not any material substance we perceive in this world, but instead is a non-perceptible substance he called the apeiron. The word apeiron is a Greek word which was constructed by combining the privative, a, indicating absence, with peris, meaning limited. Hence, the apeiron is that which is absent of limits, or the unlimited, yet it is also referred to as the boundless or the indefinite. For Anaximander, the arche, and hence underlying origin and source of the world, was a boundless and non-perceptible material substance that surrounds the world. Some have suggested that a more accurate translation of Anaximander's apeiron is the indefinite instead of the unlimited. Anaximander thought the world we experience was made out of two pairs of opposites, the hot and the cold, and the wet and the dry. These opposites correspond to the four primary elements which, as we mentioned, the Greeks thought the world was made of: fire, air, water, and earth. The two pairs of opposites, or four elements, were proposed by Anaximander to be originally mixed together with each other in the apeiron. Hence, the apeiron is not a definite material thing such as air or water, but instead is the indefinite, as all four elements are mixed together in it to form an undifferentiated mass. Because the apeiron is engaged in eternal motion, these opposites are separated out of their potential state in the apeiron, and in doing so form the world as we experience it. This process of the primary elements separating out from the apeiron is not a one-time event. Instead, Anaximander thought this separation of the opposites out of the apeiron was continuous, and could explain the flux we perceive in this world, as things are constantly being born from the apeiron, while simultaneously other things are dying and perishing, returning home, so to speak, back into the apeiron. Anaximander of Miletus, the philosopher Aetius wrote, says that the first principle of existing things is the boundless. For from this all come into being, and into it all perish. Wherefore innumerable worlds are both brought to birth and again dissolved into that out of which they came. The last of the Milesian philosophers was Anaximenes. He proposed that the arche, or underlying substance and origin of all things, was air. In calling the arche a definite substance, he seems to have failed to grasp Anaximander's insight that if the arche is to exist, it must be an indefinite substance. However, some have claimed that Anaximenes represents an advance on Thales and Anaximander because, unlike his predecessors, he gave a scientific explanation as to how the arche, air in his case, transforms itself into all the different things we observe in the world. To do this, Anaximenes utilized the physical processes known to us as condensation and vaporization. Condensation occurs when water vapor condenses, changing its physical state from a gas to a liquid. It is the process responsible for the formation of clouds and thus rain and snow. Anaximenes reasoned that if air can change into mist and water, if condensed further, it can also change into earth and rock. Vaporization is the opposite of condensation, and occurs when water changes from a liquid to a gaseous state. And following the same line of reasoning as before, Anaximenes proposed that if water can turn back into air, then if vaporized further, it could also transform into fire. Hence, Anaximenes provided a scientific theory as to how air, the underlying substance and identity of all things, can transform into water, earth, and fire, or the other three elements the Greeks thought everything was made of. While today we don't believe that all things are made of water, air, or an unlimited substance, in searching for an underlying unity amidst the plurality and flux we observe in our experience of the world, the Presocratics over 2,000 years ago were undergoing the exact search which continues to this day. In his book, The Second Creation, Makers of the Revolution in 20th Century Physics, Robert Crease wrote, "Across the globe, theoretical physicists are engaged in an extraordinary enterprise, the attempt to construct, by sheer force of reason, what some refer to, only half-jokingly, as a theory of everything. Physicists have always hoped for a unified picture of nature, and now and then individuals have actually sought one. What is remarkable about the present search is that the cream of the present generation of researchers has decided that the time may be ripe for unification." The first philosophers, the Milesians, were also engaged in an attempt, by sheer force of reason, to construct a theory of everything, and they too thought the time was ripe for unification. Although the tools have changed and our knowledge base has increased since the Presocratics laid down their bold theories, Thales, Anaximander, and Anaximenes were in search of exactly that which consumes the minds of modern theoretical physicists. In the next lecture, we will consider the life and ideas of Heraclitus.